So today what we are going to start is, we are going to talk about another type of network that we used to say as a Siamese type of network. Now the point is that, first we will have to understand that what is the problem that we are looking for. And then we will talk about that what is our architecture, because most of the time student used to say that I want to make Siamese, I wanted to make GAN, I wanted to make classification network and different types of things that you wanted to do. But always it has to be your problem first, that what is the problem. So suppose that, let's rephrase about this problem, that suppose that if I have an image, this is my image, and I want to come up with a network, say N1. And then I say this network is actually a classification network. Even if it's a classification network, it is going to have some sort of features. It has to take some sort of features. That's why I've said that we first used to come up with a network that is actually going to give you certain number of features. And given these features, you train a classifier over that. So there are different types of features that can be extracted. And we all understand till now that in the case of traditional machine learning, we have this feature extractor and classifier to different entities. Now in the case of deep learning or any neural networks, features are also being learned, and they are being learned depending upon the type of objective function. What is your final objective that you wanted to come up with? So then I say that I want to do classification. Then you say that what type of classification? If you wanted to differentiate between cat and a dog, features are going to be different. If you wanted to differentiate between a bottle and a bag, features are going to be different. If you wanted to differentiate between two bottles with different color of lid, other things remains to be the same, then features are going to be different. So this is actually the feature, and then you come up with the different types of classifiers and you train both of them in a single backpropagated manner and a two-end network. This is the usefulness of this. But you understand that if it's actually going to be a classification, then the features can actually be discriminative features. You wanted to come up with those set of features by which you can differentiate between the given set of classes. So this is one type of feature that you come up with. Then I say that can you come up with, so we have talked about ResNet, we have talked about InceptionNet, AlexNet, VGG, so many different types of network, and essentially at last they will say that here I am going to have a final layer in which I am going to have number of classes and they are being trained in such a way so as to get the discriminative feature, those set of features by which I can differentiate the given number of classes. Even if I change my number of classes, features are going to be somewhat different if you train it end to end. Now, after doing this classification, we have gone towards another type of network, that was object detection. Then we have said that given an image, I wanted to come up with a classifier that will understand that what is there in the image. You wanted to know, so you wanted to know that given this image, there is a cat. Then you say that if it's a classification, you just have to say that there is a cat. But if it's a object detection network, it has to tell that where is the cat. So classification along with localization. So you started to talk in terms of that I require that set of features by which I can not only tell you that there is this particular class, but especially where it is. Then you are going to have a regression head. Then we have said that along with this regression head, I want multiple classes, and within the same image you are going to have multiple different types of classes, and within a particular class there are going to be multiple instances of that class in the given image. Then we have come up with complicated networks of object detection. But essentially the object detector that we always have said, initially this was a classifier, then you say that classification and regression, two types of head, and then you come up with a head which is saying that I extract something, so features are going to be the same, similar type of features are going to be there, but you wanted to train another network like a classifier in the case of RCNN, like a type of classifier, which will say that object proposals are going to come, and given this type of object proposal, I wanted to differentiate between different objects. So this was faster RCN, and then you say that I wanted to address multiple scales as well. So you come up with an SSD type of approach. But these features remains to be the same. You must have seen that whatever the type of approach that we were seeing, initially we extract a type of feature that we are looking for, and over that we come up with SSD type of classification and regression, or YOLO type of, or type of faster RCNN and so. Similar to that, when you want to do the instance segmentation in which each and every pixel, as well as given in your assignment number 3, that given any image, you wanted to come up with each and every pixel level classification. Then if it's a classification, then for each and every pixel, you will say that 0 and 1, whether it belongs to the foreground or it belongs to the background. And for each and every pixel, you will get this vector. For each and every pixel, you will get 0 or 1. So for whole image, you will be getting a vector. And you have a ground truth, the corresponding vector, you find out the cross entropy between them. You can do it using the classification. You can do it as a classification type of cost, but per pixel classification task. An autoencoder type of networks can be trained because you understand that the size of your mask is going to be the same as the size of your image. So in classification or feature extraction, you must have seen that we keep on reducing the size. So that is why you require something which will take this small bottleneck and cover, regenerate the whole thing again back for you. So autoencoder networks came into our rescue, and we have seen that if I do deconvolution and upsamplings, then you can regenerate the whole thing again back, and that is why we have to set that it's an autoencoder regenerating the same thing. And then you say that instead of generating the same thing, generate me some, I'm going to give you a noisy image, can you denoise it? I'm going to give you a real image, can you make the mask for this? I'm giving you an image and I apply some non-trivial function over that, some effects, very complicated function. I apply over that and I say that if I give you X, can you give me this FX, autoencoder type of network. That's actually an encoder and decoder type of network, because now you are getting two pair of images. One is X, another one is FX. So both of them are images. So you can actually come up with function approximators using encoder decoder type of networks. So till now you all have understood that this type of thing that we have done. Now let's start and talk about one more thing. First is that if I give you an image like this and say that tell me what is there in the image, that is essentially a type of object detection that we are doing. You have to be sure that there is a bottle, there is a cat, here there is a dog, and there is a car here. These are the things that I know, these are the things that I'm sure, and I know because why you know them? Because they were there in your data set, and that is why you have come up with your hypothesis that these are the things which are in my image. Till now everything is very easy. Now the point is that there is something which is here. You are not saying that what it is. Why? Because that was not in your training samples. You have not seen that. There is something which is over here. There is something which is over here. We are not able to differentiate or find those things because they are not in our data set. So if I say that what is there in the image, it's essentially going to be what type of objects that you are seeing, then you will have to make sure that what type of object that I know that I can find out. But definitely it's not going to be infinite amount of things are there in the universe, and you cannot each and everything, you cannot understand that how it is and how it's going to be looking like. So object detection is actually a very complex and complicated type of problem. Now let us go and talk about another type of problem. And very soon you will understand that type of problem is going to be very, very essentially required, which is slightly, or one can say completely different from this type of problem. So what is that? So if I give you one image and then I give you another image, and if you remember that in Dainik Jagran, even now you can every day or maybe on Sundays you used to get two images, and they used to say that can you find out 10 differences between them, 10 differences between them, A image and B image. Here I am having something. Here I am having something. And if I show you these two images, and suppose that something like this, you do not know anything what is there. And is it required to really understand the deep meaning of each and every object which is there? Do you really require to understand what is this? What is this? And what is this? Do you really want to know that what is this and what is this? If you apply some object detection, it will say that there is an object, there is an object, and I guess that that's actually some human. It requires huge amount of understanding for this. But as soon as I say that, find out 10 differences, you started to see that thing in a completely different way. Both of those two images, you think in your mind that if I say that what is there, you are looking in a different way. Because it depends upon the objective. I say that what is there, single image, you started to see that what are the things that I know. There is a glass, there is a bottle, there is remote, there is pen. You know about these things. So you started to see like that. But as soon as I say that there are two images, can you find out 10 differences between them? You started to see in a completely different way. You started to see that here there is something, corresponding thing. Is there any something, things which are corresponding that I can find out there? You try to register both of these images in your mind. Register means that this is one hand, this is second hand. You take it and both of them are like this. You first take it, place it over here, then somehow adjust so that it becomes, you know, similar to each other. Then only you can find out the differences. So in your mind, both of these images are going to be somehow registered, and then you started to find out that how far these things are. What are the places where we are finding out the differences? You understand? This is actually a very essential problem of computer vision, and we used to call it as matching two images. We do not want you to tell that what is in first image, what is in second image. But we wanted to somehow differentiate between these two images. Are they same? Are they different? It's also a type of classification. This is going to be a type of classification problem. In this type of classification problem, first thing is that I'm going to come up with a network like this. This network somehow has to take this, and it has to tell me 1/0, 1, they are same, or they are different. Is this okay to everyone? They are same or they are different? It may not be directly seen as an image. It can be a text. Plagiarism, I wanted to check. Then I am having two things. I wanted to check that both of them are same or different. I do not want it to check. Now suppose that this plagiarism tool, it is actually telling you that this document is same as this document, but it is not even looking what is written inside. It do not have any semantic knowledge that whether it's actually a computer vision assignment, or it's actually a deep learning assignment, or it's a theoretical computer science assignment. It just check that what are the things which are same and what are the things which are different. It can be text, it can be audio, it can be video, it can be any type of media over which you wanted to look for. So what is this that you wanted to learn? This is going to be a function. Yes, every time it's going to be a function. If it's a classification, even this is also a type of classification. But here it is trying to learn a very specific type of thing. And we used to say that it's something related to the metric learning. Now, what does this metric learning mean? This metric learning essentially means that if I have two things, I wanted to come up with a function which will take these two things and can tell me that how similar or dissimilar they are. So this metric can actually be telling you the similarity, or it may be telling you the dissimilarity. So if it is dissimilarity metric, and if I give you two different images, the value should be high. And if I give you similar images, the value should be low. As well as if I give you two different same images, and if it suppose a similarity metric, then the value should have to be high. If it is a metric, then there are few properties that should have to be holding. First one is actually the identity. That suppose that this my function is, then if I give a comma a, it has to be equal to 0. If I give f a comma b, it is symmetric, then it has to be equal to f of b comma a. And the third thing is the triangular inequality, which says that from a to b and then b to c, the distance between them, a to b plus b to c, is always going to be less than, greater than the distance between a to c. That's a triangle, because all of these things are going to be your a point is this, b point is this, and c point is this. So this and this is always going to be, add this plus this, it's always going to be greater than this value. So there are few properties that any metric should have to hold. Now if you can learn this type of metric, now what will happen, that these are some strict properties which somehow have to be addressed. It may be the case, and we wanted to now come up with a network that can learn all this stuff, metric learning. It was also being the case that there are so many different types of metric functions which are being there, by which you can find out the similarity or the dissimilarity between two images. You can find out easily, and there are multiple non-deep learning ways as well. So here in our lectures, we are going to see that how we can do that. The second point is that instead of directly telling that whether it is 1 or 0, you can say that the level by which they are similar to each other or dissimilar to each other. And you find out that value, single value, and later you normalize it between 0 and 1. So if I give you two images and both of them are exactly same, the value should have to be 0 if it's a dissimilarity measure, because they are completely similar to each other. Similarly, on the other, if they are completely dissimilar, then the value should be equal to 1. So it is going to be normalized between 0 and 1. And the network that Daksh is now going to talk about is actually the type of network that we are now going to talk about. He has to start. Yeah. So that's actually CMEs.
Okay, so sir has already talked about that the problem is here, that we want to see if two images are similar to each other, rather than actually being a classification problem. Now, this problem is actually important in real life scenario as well. Like, you need handwriting recognition. You need to recognize whether the handwriting of a person is of that person itself. So you can have matching done. And basically, when you want to automatically analyze the check, now you give a check to someone. Now checks have to be manually seen. Every check has to be manually processed right now. But suppose you want to automatically process the checks. Now each person writes the amount in a different way, right? So it's a complex task to automatically check. But we can actually match whether this amount is equivalent to this amount, or we can match the signature of a person automatically, whether the signature of the two persons are same or not. So in such cases as well, automatic check detection and handwriting recognition, or when we want to detect the faces in a camera image, we want to detect whether it's a face or not, and such kind of many problems, can be easily be handled when we are working with a distant metric learning rather than simple classification or other stuff. Now, just to formulate, a metric is a function that quantifies a distance between every pair of elements. Now, metric can be seen as a measure of similarity or dissimilarity. Okay, so a metric gives me, let's say a metric is a value that provides me how dissimilar the two given elements are. So I just take any two elements in a set, the metric tells me how dissimilar they are. And a metric is actually a function which takes these two elements and provides me with one value. So it's a function having two arguments and provides me with one value. Okay, two elements, they can be images, they can be text, they can be anything. These two elements can be anything, and it provides me with one final value, how similar or technically how dissimilar these two are, how far away these two are. Now, some properties of metrics that already have been discussed, like non-negativity, a matrix has to be always non-negative because distance is always positive, right? If two things, there's no distance between two things, it's zero. But if there is some distance between two things, it has to be some positive distance. Distance can never be negative. And then of course it has to be the identity, that is, if distance between two things is zero, that is, those two things are completely similar to each other. Okay. Or if two things are completely similar to each other, then their distance has to be zero. So both ways. Not just one way around. It has to be both ways. So if the distance is zero, then I am 100% sure that these two things are completely similar to each other. And if two things are similar to each other, their distance has to also be zero. Thirdly, symmetry. I mean, if I take the distance between first element, second element, and second element, first element, they have to be same. It shouldn't matter the... In the sequence I'm taking the elements, the distance always has to be same. And finally, triangular inequality, that if I add the distance from x to y to y to z, it has to be always greater than or equal to distance of normal x to z. Simple triangular inequality. So metric needs to follow these four properties to be called the proper metric. Now, traditional approaches for matching used to be, we used to extract some features, like, okay, some fixed features, like color histograms, histogram of oriented gradients, sieve features, surf features. We used to extract some features, some fixed features from the image. So we are given an image, we have extracted some features from one image, okay. Then from second image also we have extracted the same type of features. Suppose I have extracted color histogram of one image, then I have extracted color histogram of second image. And then I finally just take L1 norm or L2 norm or some other normal measure, any measure. I can take Manhattan distance, I can take any type of distance that I want, and Mahanalobis distance. And using that distance I used to tell that how similar or dissimilar these two images are. Because see, if the images are similar, then of course their features will be similar, right? Of course, two cats will have the same features. And a cat and a dog will have completely different features. So if I extract the features from the two images, and then I compare these features and find out how dissimilar these features are, I can easily say how dissimilar these two images are. Okay. Now, the problem was, whenever we talk about any of the traditional approaches, the major problem is that the feature extraction is fixed. Okay, feature extraction is never motivated as to what the problem is. Okay, the learning of feature extraction, that's never happening. We might learn the similarity measure, like we might use a bit complicated similarity measure as k nearest neighbor or other type of similarity measure for making the similarity. We might learn the similarity measure, but we are never learning the features. The features are always fixed. But in deep learning, that's the point. So, in deep learning, we just don't learn the final classifier or final output, we also learn the features as well, depending upon the task that we are having at the end. So that was the one shortcoming of these traditional approaches for matching, and which is tackled in deep learning very well. Now, let us formally give the problem. Now, for our cases, we'll be working on images, we won't be working on other type of data. Now, to formalize the problem, we are given a pair of input images. So we are given a pair, we are given two pairs. Okay, we need to tell how similar they are to each other. Now the similarity can be defined in two ways, either a binary label. So I can give a similarity in a binary label way, like zero they are same or one different, or vice versa, the way sir said. Means basically you can provide one label to same and one label to different. Right, it's a binary classification task that I'm having. So given any two images, I want to do a binary classification for my problem to find out whether these two images are same or different. Or I can find a real number indicating how similar a pair of images are. So rather than just saying whether they belong to same class or different class, I can give a number. I can say they're similar by 0.2. I can give some real number. Okay. Now that real number can also be given. So that real number will actually act as my distance metric in this case. So I can give some real number and say that they are similar by the similarity measure between them is this. Now I can use this similarity measure in any way later on possible. I can use this similarity measure for classification. I can use it for any type of different problems that I want. But yes, sometimes getting a real number is better than actually getting a binary classifier, because real number gives me a better idea how similar these two images are. Now, how to tackle such a thing? I mean, how we can make such a system? So, suppose I have a CNN with me. Okay, so this is a CNN. Now, this CNN takes an image, X1, and provides me with some feature vector of that image. Okay, let's say the CNN is cut at its first FC layer. So this is a 128 dimensional feature vector that I am getting, okay, after the first FC layer. So there's a CNN. I give an input image to the CNN and I get a feature vector, right? Now take the same CNN. I'm taking the very same CNN, the very same weights, the architecture is same, the weights is same, the very same CNN. And I'm giving some other image, and then for that I'm getting a 120 dimensional feature vector, right? Now, as sir have already said, that this feature vector, this bottleneck vector, is actually very discriminative in classifiers as well and in other cases as well. Even in autoencoders, this feature vector is having the most important information in the least feature space that's possible. Okay, so this feature vector is very important to us, right? Now, what can we expect the behavior to be? Like, if two images are belonging to the same class, these two feature vectors will be very similar to each other, right? But if these two images are belonging to a different class, then these two feature vectors are very dissimilar to each other, right?
So here let us make it that this, whatever you are seeing, by the way, these slides are actually from Andrew and this part.
Some Andrew and this, some.
So we will we'll make sure that's being written. So see, what I want to say here is that this is a feature extraction for you. The same thing was also being done when you were doing the classification. The same thing, it was also being done when you were trying to do the object detection. This thing, you always used to get certain things. Over that you keep on training your classifier, object detector, autoencoder, whatever the thing that you want. Now this is a specific way, we will see that how we can train. But if I take a network, what it essentially is doing, it's actually a function. Function, so it will take something, it is going to give you something out. So it is taking something as an image and it's going to give you a 128 dimensional vector. You can design a network like this. You may say that no, not 128, you may want something else, maybe 256 dimensional vector, whatever. What is this function is doing? This is taking an image and projecting this image to some low dimensional space. Why you want to project it into a low dimensional space? The reason is that each and every pixel here in the image may not be responsible or maybe independently that much useful. You remember that each and every pixel, this is an image, each and every pixel is not independent. They are having huge amount of dependency. Suppose that there is a hair over here. This is black because there is a hair. The neighboring pixel is also black. And they are completely dependent upon where it is. Each and every pixel is having huge amount of dependency. Now, when you wanted to come up with this 128 dimensional, you were assuming that this is actually being projected into some high dimension, some low dimensional space. Now it depends that what is that low dimensional space where your image is going to be projected by this network. Then it will say that if you wanted to differentiate between goat and a cat or some type of things, then this type of network, I mean this classifier or this feature has to be discriminative feature. Here it has to be that we just wanted to differentiate between, two faces. It has to understand that most of the places on face, it's actually color is brown or the skin color. So skin color, or if you started to look these regions, no matter if it is human, no matter it is man or woman, no matter they are two same different persons, the same things are going to be here. If I give you only eyes, nothing else, if I strip from here and only give you these two set of eyes, even you can figure out that they are same or different. I don't want to say that who is he. I don't want to say that where is the eye. I wanted to say that these two set of eyes, can you differentiate they are same or different? Probably yes. But suppose if I only started to give you cheeks or the forehead, given only forehead, it will be very difficult for you to figure out whether they are same or different. So what will happen? If I give you two set of images, then you are not looking to the forehead. If you want to find out face, whether there is a face or not, then it's actually an object detection problem. But if I said given two images, you want to differentiate between them, you are not looking to those regions which are common. Those regions which are not having the useful information for discriminating these two set of images. And given a data set, you will be having huge amount of, pairs. Now you are not looking image as single thing. Now you are looking these images as pairs. So if you have 100 images in your data set, then 100 C2 pairs are going to be there. So huge amount of pairs you are soon going to see. Given these pairs, you wanted to come up with a function that will take an image and project it to some high dimensional, where in that high dimensional space, this 128 dimensional point is that vector is actually a point. You wanted to come up with this type of function which will take an image, project it to some high dimensional space, and in that space, if images are same, this vector has to be close. If they are different, this vector has to be far. This is the thing. This is actually the optimization. Again, you see that we have how conveniently change our problem and convert it into an optimization problem, and we let our network to somehow understand this problem and try to minimize that loss there. So we will have to come up with this loss function. So we have to know. So
we are looking at Siamese networks. I mean, we were looking at Siamese networks in the last lecture. So we have seen that how, rather than just normal classification, we can actually train some networks. We can actually make networks. Those are for distance metric learning rather than normal classification. So just a bit of recap what we did last time. First of all, we don't always need a classification. We sometimes need to just know the similarity between two images that we are having or two data points that we are having. There are many applications for that that can range in real life. So to get that similarity, we need to define a metric. Okay, so a metric is to be defined by similarity. So metric, what a metric is, a distance metric basically provides me that given any two data points, how much similar or dissimilar these two things are. Some function or some metric that provides, given any two data points, it tells me how similar or dissimilar these two things are. So if they are completely similar to each other, the distance between them would be zero. But if they are highly dissimilar, then there will be some very high distance between them. The output of the metric will be really high. Now, there are some properties of a metric. When I call something as a distance metric, there are some properties. Like, the distance metric has to be non-negative. It has to be, it has identity of discriminable. That is, if the distance metric between any two data points is zero, then those two data points have to be exactly the same. And some more properties like symmetry and triangular inequalities, they have to follow. Now, we'll come to the problem statement what we were having. So the problem statement is, given a pair of input images, we want to know how similar they are to each other. Okay. This is the input to the network, that two images, and we want to find out how similar they are. And the output can be a binary label saying whether it's zero similar or one dissimilar, or a real number indicating how similar these images are. That is like a distance metric also giving us a real number, or just a binary label whether they belong to the same class or different class. So we saw a bit of Siamese network as binary classification, right? We saw that we can have one network. We will have a network, and so this is our network. So this is one network that we are having. Okay. So this network actually, what we will do is, we will input an image xi. So xi is an image that we will input, and we will get a feature embedding of that image fxi from the network. So it's a simple CNN based neural network, which when I give an input xi, it will give me a f of xi feature embedding of that image. Similarly, from the same network, I will input some other image and I will get some other feature embedding. Right, then I can combine these two feature embeddings to finally get a single output that I want. And then I will train my network in such a way that this output has to be either 1 or 0. This output has to be either 1 or 0, depending upon whether they are of the same class or of different class. So 0, they are of same class, or 1, they are of different class. And so on, vice versa, I mean, it depends. Combining can be any way of combining it. So one very naive way is, suppose you have these two feature vectors, right? You can concatenate them, then add a FC layer, finally getting a single output. One way to combine these two feature vectors can be such a way. Other way to combine is, you can directly just take a L2 distance between them and you can get one value. Right. There can be many ways you can combine. You can actually combine using another network ahead of these two, or you can combine just taking the L2 difference of these two feature maps and then getting the final value. So there are many ways you can actually combine to get the binary classification. It's up to you how you implement it.
So let me just rephrase first that CME network binary classification. Who can tell me what is exactly happening over here? How it is different from our classification? Can you tell? How it is different from basic classification? We are bringing the same classification here. There are two. What are these two classes? Yes?
Similarity
and dissimilar. So I have two things. I want to see that whether they are similar or different. So let us understand first point that stream talking in terms of pair. There has to be a notion of pair. Till now we are not seeing in terms of pairs. We are seeing images as individually. Last words, can you tell? What does it mean when I say that I want to train a Siamese network? How it is different from basic classification? Can you tell? Yes. What is your name?
Vastu.
How it is different? You really understand that what is happening over here? What type of network that you can have over here, Vastu? CNN. Any type of CNN network you have generated? You have designed and then you are getting features from that. Now, the way in which this is being going to be trained is a different from classification. How?
Finding you are not classifying into classes.
Then
we are comparing the features.
We are comparing in a feature space that is being spanned by a particular transformation network. And in that space, what you want? That if they are similar, if a pair is similar, these embeddings has to be near, otherwise they has to be far. So this is the objective. This is my objective. Now we have to come up with, you know, different type of ways by which you can concatenate, different types of loss functions. Our objective remains the same. How you can do that, you will have to understand that if it is a classification or something, then one should have to think in a different way. If it is, again here is a classification 0 and 1. And then you will say that what are the pros and cons of this stuff. So first you will have to understand that this is one transformation network. It can be seen as a function. It will take an image going to give you a high dimensional feature vector, some dimensional feature vector, 128 dimensional something. In that high dimensional space of 128 dimensions, you wanted to find out such a network. If I show two same images, point has to be near, otherwise it has to be far. That is why we are trying to train it as a binary classification. Then he said that you can simply concatenate. If you simply concatenate, then what network has to understand? Network has to understand that the leader of this classification has to somehow understand that the first feature vector or the top entries of my feature vector are coming from my first class, and the other are going to, you know, first image and the other is coming from my second because there is a pair. And somehow I have to come up with that if they are same, I have to give them very close. And if they are different, I have to give them something by which I am going to get an output as a one. And then you will see that is it going to work or what is the best way to do that.
Sir?
Yes?
Distance metric is also learning.
Which distance metric?
After you get these two functions,
two
embeddings, then there is the distance metric that comes to get output 1 or 0.
Okay.
So that metric is also learning.
Yeah. So that is the thing that after concatenation, what you are going to do. So essentially, this is going to be seen as some sort of classifier. And this whole thing can actually be seen as a distance metric. So what it is doing, it is taking something and taking a specific feature out of that, and then you wanted to use a classifier. You can say that, oh, if you give me this type of transformation, this is going to be the classification. and that is classified between two classes, class A and class B, then you will say that no, every time I do not want class A and class B playing, I want something like how close it is for class A or how close is it for class B. And because it is actually a binary classification, so if I say that how close it is for a class A, it essentially means that 1 minus of that is the other thing. So you wanted to now come up with some final thing. Initially it is saying that I wanted to come up with a class. Later you will say that no, coming up with a class is not always a useful metric. We wanted to find out a single value which says that how close it for a particular class. 1 minus of that is that how close it for the other.
Yes. But this is just telling, this system is just telling us a binary classification as to whether they belong to the same class or not. It's not exactly a, this whole framework is not exactly a distance metric because it does not confine with the properties of distance metric. Okay, it's not exactly a distance metric. So let us change our problem statement a bit. Okay, so rather than having the output as just a 0 or 1 output, we will get an output as some D. So D will be some output of our network where when the network is given image 1 and image 2, D is a degree of difference between these images. So rather than just getting 0 and 1, we want to get some real value D, some real number D from the network that this is the difference between these two images. And if this D is smaller than some threshold T, if the distance between two images is small than some predefined threshold, then we will say the images belong to the same class. Otherwise, we will say that the images belong to different classes. Okay. So here, rather than just getting a 0 and 1 output from the network itself, that the images belong to same class or not class, different class, what the network will do is, a network will actually provide me a measure, some measure of difference between the images. Okay, now if this measure of difference is less than some threshold, that is this measure of distance is actually low, I will say that these two images belong to the same class. Otherwise, if it's more than some threshold, I will say these two images belong to a different class. Okay, now the task comes to how to train such a system. I mean, it's again, there are different ways to do it actually. It depends upon what problem statement to problem statement. It can also be computed empirically by doing some experiments. Or one way to do it is basically creating an ROC curve. So you change the threshold. We'll talk about that.
There is a way to come up with this
key. Can you have any number of classes or any? No, this can be for any number of classes.
Then my point is how many classes are here first of all? If I have a pair of images, don't try to confuse with classification. If I have a pair of images, how many classes do I going to have? Always, it may be cat or dog or whatever the class that you are thinking of. But ultimately you are having a pair of images, you just want to know that are they same or are different. So there are always going to be two classes.
So, if there are many classes,
whatever. You have 1000 classes. I say that choose two. And then my question is that are they on the same bag or different? Same class or different? Question always refers to the same. Are they coming from the same class or different class? So whatever the number of classes, it is irrespective of that. First thing. There is another thing that just think about that you have 1000 classes. With a lot of classes. But each class having 5 images. Then you will say that we do not have a huge amount of, you know, per class images. We do not have to. That is why this Siamese is also moving towards one short classification, few short classification, which essentially mean that for each and every class, if I have only one image, two images, or very less amount of images, can you pray? Now there comes the, first of all, this comes as a call of our convolutional network. It essentially says that even if you have 2 classes or 5 classes or whatever small number of classes, you have to show me huge amount of images so that I will be able to understand that are they coming from the same class or different class, the classification. But as a human, do I require to show you 1000 images of the same class? No, you train yourself very fast. Then we start to talk that what is the way by which we and a few short learning. Why short learning? One shot only one event per class. Now the point is that due to this scarcity, you cannot train your network as a classifier. You understand? Last layer 1,000 neurons. Then you will say that okay, for 1,000 classes and only 5 images per classes, and I will say that take this 5,000 images. I just want to check that whether they are coming from the same class or different class. So you are going to come up with pairing. How many pairs you can make? 500C2. The huge amount of pairings you require. Not a, you know, using this type of metric, we can also come up with a type of classifier as well. You can classify between one versus rest, if you remember. One versus rest. So you take one class and say that whether it's a cat or not. It's a dog or not. So if you have 1,000 classes and if you have one versus rest or one or a binary classification, then using 1,000 one versus rest, you can do some sort of voting and then you will get something like what is the 1,000 class classification as well. But the point one should have to understand is if you have very less amount of data, instead of going and trying to learn the class specific features, to learn class specific features, you will have to train it as a classifier, but you do not have that much amount of images. So we change our objective from there to another domain. That is actually the big difference between our classification model as well as our machine learning or scale this type of networks. Now that we say that instead of learning the class specific features, I started to learn the discriminative features between images. And even if you can do that, you probably do not require huge amount of images. If I say that these two images are same or different, you are not looking very closely to understand that whether it's a cat or it's a dog. So that's what you say that they are different. And they are same. So the problem is going in a different direction. So our network is going. And that is actually also becoming a need. In this way, probably you will be able to talk about something that you have not even seen. You have seen certain classes and then only you are predicting. Now suppose that if I have not seen any class and if you show me that class image, can I say that is it same as a cat or not? Yes, you can say. Because it has been trained in such a way so that to distinguish between images are same or different. Try to always understand, because whatever the problem that you want to solve, these are all actually the guidelines and these are going to be the architecture that one should have to use. You will have to think that what is my problem? Now your problem is face detection, face recognition. Face recognition, this type of network has to be working. You want it to track a particular person in subsequent frames. In one frame I give you one, what is the location of this person? It has to be tracked in the upcoming frame. Siamese network can be useful. I think you have done one work in which you were showing that Siamese and number of classes were more, but not too many images were there. So he first trained a Siamese. So once you train the Siamese, the features are being trained. This network, you remember, the CNN network. To take that feature and then use that feature for classification. So instead of training a classifier directly, because you do not have too much amount of images, instead of training that, you say that I want to work on pairs. I want to work on pairs, but I will use amount of pairs. Once I understand that, can I use this pairs information, pre-train my network, and then retrain it over or fine tune it over my small amount of data, whatever you want.
I think this is the thing that you have.
So they have shown that using this type of concept, probably you will get some class specific features as well. So initially it is learning the differences, and then it started to learn the class specific features. So because it is being pre-trained, you are only fine tuning the things, small amount of data may be used. Understood?
No.
So now just rather than getting a binary classifier, we want to get a similarity measure, real number based similarity measure. So this is a standard Siamese CNN that we talk about. Okay, so we have a CNN basically two CNNs, but the weights are common. See, the weights are shared here. The weights are common. They will always be the same. So these two CNNs are actually same. You can also say that there's only one CNN which is being used two times. Okay, so there's only one CNN. So I take an image, I get some output of that image, DX2. I take another image and I get its output, DX2. And then I take the L2 distance between them. And this L2 distance will provide me of how similar or dissimilar they are. Right. So I just repeat it once. So basically CNN gives me a feature embedding. CNN will give me a feature embedding, right? Okay. Now, over this feature embedding, if I input the image x1, I will get some feature embedding dx1, right? And for the image x2, I will get some feature embedding dx2. Now, these are two features that I am having. If I just take an L2 distance between these two features, I will get some difference between these features I will get. Okay. So, if I just restrict my network to this path, I am actually getting a distance between the features. Okay. Now, I have to train this network such that the features that belong to the same class are close to each other and the features that belong to different class are far away from each other. So this is how this network has to be trained. Now to do that, the loss function that we can think is, see, we were getting GWX1 for the X1 image, okay, the output for the X1 image, and we have the output for the X2 image. So we take some distance measure, okay, we take the L2 distance between these two feature embeddings, we get one value DW, we get one value, right? Now our target is that if these two images belong to the same class, if they are similar classes, our target is to make this DW as small as possible. If these two images are of similar images, these two are similar, so here these two belong to the same class aeroplane, so my target is to make this DW as small as possible. Okay, so if I train my network such that it to make the two images of same class as small as possible, okay, so I can train the network in this way, but there's one problem with this. You are missing one very important thing. Now here it will learn, here it will try to learn. Basically what I'm making the network to learn is that, okay, these two images belong to the same class, so the embeddings has to be close to each other. So that's the only information I'm giving to the network. Is it enough? Yeah, I mean the problem with this formulation is basically what would happen is that the network will try to learn a very trivial solution. It will just project each and every image to a single point, irrespective of which class it belongs to, irrespective of what image it is. Because all it is learning is, given any two images, I have to make the distance small, so I just project each image to a single point, let's say 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. The network will project each image at 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and we won't be able to differentiate between different class images. Okay, so we need to add another loss function with it. So for same class images, we need to make this DW small. But for different class images, we may need to make this DW large.
Do you understand this? Because this is actually the problem that anyway when you train it is going to happen. First understand that W is there, W is shared. Remember it is shared. How it is implemented? Don't worry right now. You think about there is a network and this network is shared or single network is there. First you take first image, take it inside. Then you take a second image, take it inside. Find out the GWX1, GWX2, then different computers. Subtract both of them or basically two vectors, find out the altitude amount between them and see that more or less basically whatever the value I want to make it 0 or make it 1. Now the point as he has said that if we take and say that everything is similar, if you are saying that everything has to be same, if they are same, coming from the same subject, the value is going to be 0. So the trivial thing that you can learn, if I say that every time you will have to give me 0, then you will learn that whatever you are giving me, I will protect into 0, 0, 0, 0. Or I will protect everything into 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Or I will protect into some vector which is fixed. That vector is fixed. So whatever you give, every time it will be mapped to this. So now all the pairs are going to map to the same value, all these images, and because of that each and every pair is similar. So this is easy to learn for any network. So then you say that, no, you will have to understand this thing as well, that if I give you something else, if they are not in the same class, you have to say one. So then he started to understand this point, because we also have to, wrap up the IUB. So here, what will happen that this is one thing, this is another thing. So if you understand that this is going to be somehow captured in our loss function, you have to check what? That if they are coming from, till now we have not done it like that. Till now we have been done it, this is my loss function. Now your loss function is saying that if it is coming, if both of them are the same class, you have to say 0. If they are different, I have to say 1. Depending upon the ground truth, your loss will also be changed. So because of that, we are going to come up with one loss that he is going to talk about. But the second point is that, is there any problem in that? When I say that two images, they are same or different, I just have said that first I show this pair. So my network will compute my loss. And I will say that make it 0. Then I will show this pair. Network will again compute a loss. And then I will say make it 1. And within a batch, you have 5 or 10 such pairs. 10 such pairs. Some of these pairs has to make it 0. Some of these pairs has to make it 1. So within a batch, it is actually going to see all this system, all these things. Fine. Now comes the third point, that there is going to be some big problem in this. Or if I say that they have to be same or different, then you will say that less or small. With respect of what? If I say that you will have to tell me a small number. I say, Nikhil, tell me a small number. You will take 5. 5 is a small number for you. Then I say, no, 5 is a big number. I am only talking about 0 and 1. Between 0 and 1. Then you will say that 0.2. I say, no, I am giving you a 0.002. Then you will say 0.002. I say, no. Auto encoder loss can go up to 2 power 10, 10 power minus 8, minus 6, minus 4. I am looking at it. So, if I say that give me a small or a big number, it has to be with respect to something. Here, within this thing, if I say this is small, what is small? What is big? What is small? Then you will say that within a batch, I will check. Within a batch, I will check that for this it has to be low, for this it has to be high, and this is with respect to each other. But it is only with respect to a batch. Can I go to a second step of familiarity that within my loss function, can I come up with a reference in which I say that you will have to make this thing low and this thing high? That is actually from double or the pair of images, we will go on to the triplet loss. I will have to leave.
Okay, so. So now we have two losses. One loss is to make the similar images, distance between the similar images small, and one loss will be to make the distance between the different images large. So the final loss will be, the loss will be that so all of the loss for all of the positive pairs plus loss of all of the negative pairs that we are having, and we will add them. Okay, so this is called contrastive loss function. So this is contrastive loss function. Okay. So there can be many different losses for positive pairs and negative pairs. You can have different type of losses for positive pairs. You can have different type of losses for negative pairs. But I will cover the one which are used the most, which are actually, they're not used the most, but they actually work. So for that, see, for positive pairs, the loss is pretty easy. Since I have to minimize the distance, I can just say minimize the Euclidean distance between these two. Normal L2 loss. Right, because I have got two values, GWX1, GWX2, right? All I can say is just take their L2 distance and make it 0. Because these two are similar images, right? Very simple task, minimize the L2 distance, L2 norm of the both the embeddings. So the loss for positive images is same, it's just the normal Euclidean loss function that we are having. A simple Euclidean loss function. That is to embeddings, to just make the embeddings as close to each other. So that the distance between these two embeddings tends to zero when they are of same class. So that way the network learns that, okay, for the same class, I have to make this distance as low as possible. Of course, ideally zero is not possible, but as low as possible the network will learn, but we will force it to learn it as zero. But the trick comes, see, the trick here comes is to the make this large. I mean, our networks, the systems that we train in CNN, or all the optimizations that we do in CNN, they are based on minimizations. Okay, in every optimization, we say minimize this loss function, minimize this cost function. We never talk about maximizing something. But here the task is maximizing. So how actually this can be done is, now, let's say we have a network. Okay, we have an image. We have got an output from that image. Let's say we have got a P output from that image, a feature vector P. Okay, we have another image from the same network. We have got the output as Q. Okay, now my task is that distance between P and Q, I have to maximize it. I have to maximize this distance. Okay, but the maximization is not possible. So I can rewrite it as that I want to minimize this distance. Okay, I want to minimize this distance minus of it plus alpha. Sorry, infinity. Okay, so now what I'm saying is make this distance as close to as infinity as much possible. Make this distance as much as close to infinity as possible. Right, so if this distance is high, this loss will be low. If this distance is infinity, minus infinity plus infinity, the output is, assuming some high number, the output will be zero. But if this value is low, very low, the loss is very high. Right, so I'm saying that you have to minimize that to make this distance as to infinity. But of course, we cannot model infinity. Right, so we will tend to bound these P and Q. We will bound these P and Q. How we will bound, we can apply an activation. Let's say we apply sigmoid activation here. Okay, and it's a 128 dimensional vector. So we have applied sigmoid activation to a 128 dimensional vector. Right, so what I can get? I can get 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, the least value, and I can get 1, 1, 1, the maximum value. Right. So if I just take a L1 distance between these two vectors, what is the maximum L1 distance possible between two sigmoid vectors? 128. Right. So I have a bound. My distance between two vectors, if they are having a sigmoid activation, cannot be greater than 128. Right. So now I can change that infinity to 128. So what I can minimize is some 128 minus the distance I want to minimize. So I have to minimize this, 128. Now this 128 can change with respect to the activation that you are using and how many dimensional vectors that you are having. So we will rewrite it as to minimize M minus P minus Q.
So, you understood? No.
So we will minimize M minus P minus Q. But so this can be one of our loss functions, right? If we make the distance between any two dissimilar images to be to 128 and for any two similar images to be zero, we can work with it. But there's a problem. Okay. Let's suppose I have two classes, right? Now the distance of 128 is only possible between the vectors this and this, right? So if I have just two classes in my system and I want to make a Siamese network on those two classes, ideally, it will learn to project one class to 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 and project another class to 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 because I'm forcing the distance to be 128, right? But what if a third class comes in my formulation? Now, the third class, suppose it's projected to 0.5, 0.5, 0.5. Now, see, the distance between this is 64. The distance here is 64, right? So, if it tries to maximize this distance to 128, this distance is minimized. But if it tries to maximize this distance is minimal. Understood this point? This point is actually important. Right. So, hence, when we are trying to just maximize the distance to the maximum range of the function that we are having, it creates problem when we are dealing with multi-class issues. when we have multiple classes in a system. So rather than having M as the maximum possible distance in that domain, we will choose a margin.
Before
some
that,
small margin.
Maybe slightly confusing that if you say that two classes, now this third class is coming. What are two classes here? Same or different? We are not talking about classes like cat, dog, this and that. I'm only talking about same or different. Now if I say that same or different, and then what will happen? That it is just like yes or no binary answer. Like in you are going to vote for Modi or Kejriwal. So then you say no, I don't say yes or no, I will have to say one more line. So you want to say that. So that is actually better than saying yes or no for your justification. So same thing, if I show you two images, I say same or different, and you are saying that they are looking like same, but there is huge amount of difference as well. How can I say that it is 0 or 1? So that is why you started to say that instead of one thing that is coming, can I have from 0, 0, 0 to over 1, 1, 1, range, there is actually a finite amount of distance. Okay, I mean, there is a finite amount of distance, but we can discretize it into infinite points. And then I say that something which is standing in between. And that class is that this is same, this is different, this is similar. They're same, but close to same, and there is something which is close to different. Then you have multiple classes which are coming in between that. Instead of giving me a single thing, now you started to come up with something which will say that yes, may be similar, may be different, or in between something which is, you know, not a similar or a different thing, that you want to come up with some single value. So that is why the first thing that we have to understand, that everything has to be the minimization framework. That is why 1 minus of p minus q, 1 or the maximum value whatever you have, if you divide everything into and come up with say 0, 1 thing, you can project every distance between that unit sphere, single point, and unit sphere. If you go here, it is at 128 value, so your radius is 128. That is the maximum that you can have. The distance is going to be within that 128 radius sphere. So that is why you subtracted 128 from that, so that becomes a minimization framework. But the other thing that is now coming into the picture is that if I want to come up with another, you know, classification which is coming in between, and that is so. It is going to help your network, because your criteria is going to be very, very tough when you say that it has to be 0 or has to be 1. It is just like grading. When I grade, then I always try to have a soft boundary so that there has to be, you know, something which is, you know, some amount of number is being changed to say B. It should not be going into A. So instead of coming up with a hard boundary, we want to have some soft boundaries that can help us, help our networks to perform better, not only perform better, but to generalize better basically. And should not be overfitted over a particular thing, and our performance will also be, you know, getting, and network will also be able to train properly. Otherwise, if I say that learn something, you should say that all the similar, 0, all the dissimilar, 1. And every time I will beat up my network, that if it is not, this is your loss, such a high loss, you will not be able to print, completely oscillating, and you will not be able to run it properly. And even if they are going to be similar, and right away, those things are actually, if you remember, the two classes, and this is the hyperplane, these are going to be those points which are very near to our hyperplane, the four vectors, if you say. They are the most important thing for which one should have. Let our network understand. They are the confusing point. Otherwise, these are very dissimilar. Cat and dog are completely dissimilar. Most of the time, you are going to get embedded which are very far. You are not worried about that, because the network anyway can understand. It has to somehow understand things which are very confusing or similar. So, because of that, they started to have multiple fuzzy things, and because of that, this margin is now going to come in.
Yes, sir, I'm coming to. So the loss function that comes out to be is.
You can also minimize
1 by p minus q, then it could become unstable at zeros when it initially. See, we want to maximize it, but at initial stages, what happens is that. Okay, I will come to that later after the class, basically.
But yeah, so this. Also, there are multiple other things that minus of that is actually linear. Hmm. 1 by x is going to be not be a linear. So the behavior of that is not exactly the same.
Sure.
One thing is going to be like p minus q.
Q.
Other thing is going to be max,
max.
Of some
min of 1 by
some max minus p minus q. So both of these things has to be in sync.
Same.
Otherwise it will create problem. One thing is something p and then 1 minus p. So both of them, if I change p, then p will be behaving in a different way. 1 by p will be doing in a completely different way. X or 1 by x function if you see. Y equal to x, single line. Y equal to 1 by x is going to be a type of, you know, a different type of curve. Not linear.
So the loss function changes to here small m p by q where m is less than m. So now I will, for different images, what I will say is that make the distance not towards the maximum value that's possible 128 but to a smaller value. I can fix this value as some small value as compared to 128 like 50 or something like that. Okay, so given any two images of different class, so make them stretch them, the distance between their features should be 50. Okay, I'm not saying that should be completely 128, so that some means some flexibility is there for the network to learn. But now suppose, let's say in this case, okay, the distance between P and Q comes out to be 60. Okay, I've trained my network and I've given two inputs, P and Q. I've got two embeddings, P and Q. These two embeddings belong to different classes. Right, and the distance comes out to be 60. I was saying my margin is 50. I was saying to differentiate it by a distance of 50, but it's already at a distance of 60. So I should be happy, right? Because I'm already saying the distance between these two embeddings should be 50. But it's saying it's actually more than that, it's 60. I should be actually happy. But here the loss is going to be negative. The loss is going to be minus 10. Yeah. So hence to remove that part, what we do is, we take maximum of 0, m minus p minus q and then minimize it. So now what I'm doing is, so if this p minus q is greater than m, the loss will be 0. Okay, and if this p minus q is less than m, then the loss will be m minus p minus q. So basically what I'm saying is, so suppose this is my margin. So if the distance is somewhere between them, I would say push this distance to margin, right? But if the distance is already greater than margin, I'm happy. The loss will be 0 at that case. So it's like a hinge. So if the thing is before that hinge, I would say penalize it. But if the thing is after hinge, I'm happy with that. It, whether it be 60, whether it be 70, whether it be 128, I'm happy with that. Okay, because see, cat and dog are completely dissimilar. So if I'm trying to train a system which can also differentiate between leopard and cheetah, it will definitely make cat and dog really far away from each other. Because it has to also differentiate between leopard and cheetah. I'm saying make leopard and cheetah to 60. So of course it has to make cat and dog to like 100 far. So as to understand that leopard and cheetah will be 60. Right. So that's why we use this, we make a hinge function using a maximum from 0 and this one. So this is a final loss function that's called the hinge loss function that we are
having. It's just a hint, so which essentially means that if you have to perform within a particular threshold, if it is, then I am okay. I do not want everyone should be getting 100 out of 100 in my exam, but if you are getting more than 40, fine. If you are less than 40, then I am going to work on you. I am giving you some sort of penalty. If it's 60, it is differentiable in mean and max, so it's being done within that loss function. TensorFlow is now working over that and it started to come out with so many layers. So it is done. Differentiation is not an issue for this. Anyway, minimization is going to happen. So you take this thing, and this is anyways going to be something 0 and 1, and that is actually being handled inside the network. Do you have any idea that implementation-wise?
Actually, for max, for these type of functions, TensorFlow has actually fixed their derivatives already. According to the arguments that have been passed. They fixed the derivatives. So whichever argument is toggled, the derivative will be accordingly that. So then they don't compute actual derivatives, they compute approximate derivatives. Using numerical methods, and sometimes they fix the derivatives.
Even for the ReLU at 0, it is
code is differentiable, yeah, to fixed inside fixed. The code, that if it is 0, then this is the value. To take and do approximately.
Now, so I will say this as a hinge loss.
But training by this is going to help.
Yeah.
You know, this is actually a what do you say, adjustable function. So it is not that much complicated, or one say restrictive function. It's not that much restrictive function. It will say that whatever be the value, I wanted to get something that you can do. I do not want everyone to be playing like Virat Kohli. But if you are playing more than a particular threshold, it is okay and fine. Everyone cannot play like Virat.
So this is my hinge loss function, which is for negative pairs I am having. For positive pairs, I had an Euclidean loss function. Okay, so how to combine these two in an implementation framework? So I will take a vector y. Okay, now y will is the I will multiply y with en plus minimize. Now what I'm doing here is, now suppose that I'm giving two images that are of same class, okay? With that, I will give a label, y label as 1. Then I want to train the network for same classes, okay? Now since the y label is 1, this will become 1, it will be trained by Euclidean loss, and this will become 0, it won't be trained by a hinge loss, because these two images were belonging to the same class. But if these two images belong to a different class, I will give a label 0 with that. Okay, now giving that label 0, this will be 0, the Euclidean loss will not be used, but 1 minus y, this will be 1, 1 minus 0, the hinge loss would be used. So with this, the labels that I am providing is again 0 and 1, like what I did in binary classification. Okay, the same, I had a pair of image and I am providing 0 or 1 if they are dissimilar or similar, right? The labels are same, but the way they are trained, they are not trained to actually give me a 0, 1 output, but they are trained to give me a distance between these two images. Okay, so this is finally your contrastive loss that we are having, and to train it, the batch is actually formed. Suppose the batch size is of 32. Okay, the batch is formed this way. So here is a pair of images and then 1 or 0 respectively to that. So this is my data and this is my label. So the data, for each data point in classification, it's always one image and then we have a label with it. But in this case, we will have two images and a label with it. Similarly, next two images and a label with it. Similarly, next two images and a label. So this way, we will have 32 pairs with 32 labels. Okay. So this will be how I will construct my batch for training the system. And this is how I will construct my loss function so that I can toggle with 1 and 0 which loss to use, either Euclidean loss or hinge loss.
So Euclidean loss is for when it is the same and when it is different. So there is another concept that you can learn, that if you have two such losses, one for one class, second thing for other class, you can combine in one time. Clear? And then the whole thing becomes a single loss and then it will be optimized. Everything will be minimized. And so we will finish over here.
Yeah, just one last thing.
One last thing.
So one last thing. So we can have, I talked about Siamese network, but we can have various types of Siamese architectures, right? Rather than sharing the network, we can also have completely one network and provide two images and just concatenate those images and then provide it to the network. Okay, make a single image by combining these two images, provide to the network, and network will tell me how similar or dissimilar they are. I can also make a Siamese network in such a way, a dissimilarity network. Okay, another.
Initially, it has been done. You take both of these images, combine and show your network. Later, you say that I have two patches.
Now, in another cases, what we can do is, it's not necessary that I share each layer of the Siamese network. So there can be some initial layers which can be unshared.
Maybe the anyways to start.
Okay, sir. Just tell this.
Last minute, sir. So how to start? Yeah.
Okay, so till now we have seen the simple Siamese architectures, how one can use Siamese as a binary classification. Now, binary classification as to whether the two given images belong to a same class or they belong to a different classes. Or we can actually have a Siamese as a distance metric, which rather than just giving whether they belong to a same class or different class, it just tells us how much similar or dissimilar two images are. Okay, so, and to train such a Siamese network, we saw this. So we basically saw this loss function, the contrastive loss function, as to how the contrastive loss function has two things: the Euclidean loss for the images that belong to the same class and the hinge loss for the images. And the hinge loss for the images that belong to different classes, and how we can toggle them by using a label Y. So we can toggle them by using a label Y. So as to when we are giving them images which belong to the same class, we'll put the label as 1. Otherwise, when we are giving the images that belong to a different classes, we'll put the label as 0 for that training batch. Okay. Now, one aspect in such a training, there are many problems with such training framework. Okay. Now, let's assume I have 100 classes. Okay, and each class I have, let's say, 4 examples. 4 training examples I have in each class. Okay. Now, if I pick one training example, let's say class 1, first training example. How many positive pairs can I make for this training example? In each class, I have 4 training examples. So, how many positive pairs I can make? 3 positive pairs, or we can even say 4, we can make a positive pair with itself as well. So, we can make 4 positive pairs, right? But how many negative pairs can be made? 99 into 4. That's 99 classes into 4. So, the positive pairs, we have 4. And the negative pairs, we have 99 into 4. So, there's a big misbalance between the two pairs that we are having, positive and negative pairs. So, if we show all of these pairs, the network will get biased towards negative pairs. It will start giving a very high distance for all of the... for any input, it will start giving a high distance because the network will get biased towards the negative pairs. Okay, so hence why this problem occurs is because when we are giving a pair, we are either telling the network to either they are similar to minimize the distance or they are dissimilar to maximize the distance. So these two are completely different jobs that we are having. Okay, one job says given such an input, you have to run towards left, and the other job says given some other type of input, you have to learn towards right. And we're assuming that a network will be able to learn that when to go left, when to go right. But they are very contrasting things that the network needs to do. Okay, so we are saying the network to do two very opposite things for some given inputs, and we're trying and hoping that a network will be able to learn what it's actually trying to achieve. It's trying to achieve that, okay, these two images are similar, hence make them close, but these two images are dissimilar, hence make them far. Because see, at the time only one of these will be toggled. Both of them won't be toggled simultaneously. Right? So at one time we are forcing network to say these two images are, means you have to minimize it, and one time we are saying you have to maximize it. So two very contrasting things we are doing simultaneously and trying that network should learn. So that's why contrastive losses are not actually able to train that very well. They have a bit of problem. And they usually tend to a very trivial solution in which it tries to give a same distance metric for any two given images. So I give any two given images, it will give me a distance of 0.6, 0.6, 0.6 every time. Because it can't able to understand what is actually I'm trying to learn here. What is the thing that the final objective function that I want. Okay. So
this bias problem you understand? Bias problem. What is this bias problem? See, otherwise what will happen that you this contrastive loss, what is contrastive loss? With this contrastive loss, then he said that bias problem. Anyway, in any type of problem, this bias problem is going to come. When you say that positive samples are less than the negative samples, here you are having two classes. You are talking about a pair. It can be genuine matching, or you say that both of them are coming from the same or coming from the different. There are two classes. For one class, most of the time, for every subject, you are going to have only four. So So three or four genuine matchings or same pairs you can have. So it is essentially like huge amount of bias between them. Now with this bias, what will happen is that you will make a batch. Within a batch, you are going to show multiple pairs. Pair number one, pair number two, in such a way 500 pair you are showing. Out of that, how many are going to be positive? How many are going to be negative? Then you have seen, because it's a big number. So only 1 or 2 or 5% are actually of the other class. Then what will happen? You predict something very big. Because what will happen? That you predict something very big because you do not want it to, you know, ignore the majority. Because if you ignore the majority, your loss is going to be very, very high. You can ignore the minority. So it started to ignore in such a way so that whatever these three or four things which are being there, you give them high. Loss will be high, but that is only for four and remaining things are correct. So because of that, the overall loss over a particular batch started to be reduced and it started to move in that direction and it becomes higher. This is one thing. This is actually not much related to, one can say that, you know, any type of classification is going to have this type of problem. There are ways one should have to understand how to somehow come up with, you know, bias problems, somehow have to solve. But there is another thing, which is the main problem of our contrastive loss. What is that? If you remember in our last lecture, you are going to talk about the triplet next.
Triplet, yes.
That's the next thing. So now our point is that when I show you any pair within that single, if I show you a batch, at least there is 5% or 8% or whatever bias is there, you are having that much amount of one class and remaining of the other class. So you know that what you want to do at least. Wanted to differentiate. Then I have said that within a particular sample, only one sample is there, and suppose that the batch size is only one. And then I say that make it high, make it low, make it high, make it low. Now with respect to what? Is it possible to make it high or make it low, or even you can talk about the margin and other thing? But the point is that the way Nietzsche has said that hinge. So the point comes that within one, you know, one pair, do you really have that only one thing, you know, either you will have to match or you will have to min. There is no with respect of the thing which is coming. So if one should have to understand, it's actually one way bounded loss function. Only it is saying go this way or go that way. Is there a way? So this is actually the problem. You have to understand that, okay, this is the problem. That he is saying that either it has to be high or it has to be low, it has to go in a particular direction. Within a batch, you know that these has to be, if I add this thing, these are the positive, it has to go low, it has to go high. But within particular single instance of a pair, you do not know that what is, you know, the other thing that you wanted to optimize. So what one should have to do in such cases? Do you understand the problem first of all? That's a one-sided thing. I'm saying that make it high or low. What is the other way around? It's like data notation. You remember? We talk in terms of data structure, then I say that it's upper bounded, it's lower bounded. Then we come up with a theta notation. It's upper as well as lower bounded. Now I want to say that this thing has to go high, this thing has to go low.
Upsample.
Yes, yes. Upsample
to your lower.
Upsample like, suppose that you have 100 by 100, then the upsample to 200 by 200. You want to increase the within one pair. You only have that much amount of information that whether it has to be 1 or it has to be 0. You wanted to know that I want to see both of these classes at once. Show me both of these classes at once and let me come up with something that can maximize the distance between these classes. You understand? If I say that I show you something, do you like that? But I'm not telling that what next I'm going to show. You will say that yeah, I like chocolate, but then I'm going to give you a car. So that is even better option that you can have. The same thing that if there are two classes, one should have to understand that while I'm showing you one thing, you also wanted to know that, okay, it is good, but tell me with respect of God. Then I show you something else. Here there are two classes. I want to say that you have to some, I'm showing you both of these classes. You will have to learn a metric that can create a discrimination between them. As soon as I say, only single player is not going to help because there are two classes, so there has to be two pairs. Then you can have pair 1 and pair 2. From there actually triplet is going to be started.
So this is actually also done in cross entropy laws. See, when we train using cross entropy laws, suppose we have 10 classes, right? And one image belongs to cat class. So the output that we give, the label that we give is 1, 0, 0, everything is 0. So we tell the network to maximize the output for the cat, but also minimize the output for rest of the classes simultaneously. Okay, tell it it's a cat, but also don't say it's a car. The probability of it being a car should also be 0. So even in cross entropy laws, we try to compensate all of the outputs that we are having, not just the output, not just the class we are looking into. But here we are just looking at that very pair, whether it's positive or negative. So the network get easily confused because it does not know what is the overall objective function. So at when I'm showing one pair, it's not clear what my overall objective function is. But now let's assume that, now to solve it, we will go into triplet laws. Okay, now what a task is that I have to choose such a pair or I have to choose such data, and the loss function should be that at a single loss computation or at a single backpropagation, I am clear of what I have to do. Okay, so there are two things that I have to do. I have to minimize same class and I have to maximize different classes, right? So I need to put these two objective functions in a single way, that a network, while I'm showing one pair or one triplet, the network is able to understand the complete objective function that it's having. Okay, so for that, what I will do is, I will choose an image. Let's say I've chosen an IA image. From a data set, I've just chosen any image. Okay, let's say it belongs to second class. It belongs to second class. I've chosen an image which belongs to second class. Okay, I'm calling this anchor image. IA stands for anchor image. So this is an anchor image that I have chosen. Okay. Now I also choose another image. This is also from the same class, the second class.
See, assume this is not the class, the second subject.
Second subject, yeah.
Classes are anyways two. For the classification that you are learning, classes are two.
Two.
What are they? Same pairs coming from the same subject, pairs coming from the different subject. But here he is saying that second subject, suppose that the second person is ABC.
C.
So IA is of the ABC. IP is, that's a, also an ABC. Some other image, that is why it is positive.
Yeah. So basically, since this IP belongs to the same class as the same subject, that of an IA, so we will call it as a positive image. Okay, this is a positive image because it belongs to the same subject as the anchor images. So it's a positive image with respect to the anchor. Okay, then I can choose an image IN which belongs to any other subject except the second subject. I can choose, let's say, 10th subject. I can choose from the 10th class, 10th subject. Okay, so this IN belongs to some other subject which is not the same subject as IA. So this is a negative. So this is a negative image that I am choosing. Right? So this is a negative image. So because this does not belong to the same class, it belongs to some other class. Now, what my Siamese network does, what the CNN does it? It takes an image and gives an embedding for that image, a feature map for that image. So for IA, it gives me a feature map of XA. For IP, I get XP. And for IN, I get XN. So if I show the IA image to my network, I get a feature map XA. Similarly, if I show IP, I get a feature map XP. And I show IN, I get a feature map XN. So now, the distance between...
So let me first ask that you have got a network which is going to give you again the features. Remains to be the same, the initial shared network. Now my point is that if I have XA, XP and XN, what is your expectation from your network? Aman, can you tell? From you, XA, XP and XN, what do you feel your network should have to do about these embeddings? So that is why we are saying that there is an anchor. With respect to this anchor, I have a positive. With respect to this anchor, I have a negative. I want to find out a distance this. I want to find out a distance this. I want my network to train in such a way so that the distance between this and the distance between them has to be far as possible. This is our now going to be the objective. This is going to solve which problem of one-sided loss. Anyways, that number of pairs and other things are anyways going to be there, because pairing within a batch, if I do it in this way, then even for the same image, I mean, the number of pairs are again going to be reduced further, because previously you was having, you know, three images, then one has to be for the positive, one has to be for the negative, so one anchor, then one positive. So in this way, how many positives you can have? With respect to that, how many negatives you can have? So pairs can be more, but options are anyways not going to be incremented if I say that pair bias is there. Pair bias is anyways going to be here as well. For that, augmentation will be done, that we will talk of. Hard negative mining will be required, that we will also talk about. But as soon as I say that we are coming from two triplet loss, you have to understand that the one-sided loss or contrasted loss, that was actually the problem that's being solved using triplet. So now our objective is to maximize this gap between them.
So I can define the distance between AN to be XA minus XP. The Euclidean distance between XA and XP, right? The Euclidean distance between the embeddings XA and XP is actually the distance between A and P, and the distance between A and N will be XA minus XN, right? The distance between anchor and the negative image is the distance between the embeddings of anchor and negative, the Euclidean distance between the embeddings of anchor and negative. Now, as the sir said, the distance between anchor and positive should be less than the distance between anchor and negative, right? That's our objective function that we are having. Okay, so the objective function that comes out to be that anchor and positive should be less than equal to the distance of anchor and negative. So this is what we want to achieve. Okay, but there's a trivial solution for this. Very trivial solution for this. Just put both the distances as zeros. Zero is less than equal to zero. It's solved. Yes, this equation, if each of the embeddings is zero, X is also completely zero, XP is also completely zero, XN is also completely zero. So all the distances are zero, so this equation is still solved.
All right. Of them are zero independently, or all of them are same.
Same.
So it can also take you towards the zero thing. So that's the trivial thing that again we can learn. Same thing that we also
have. So what we do is we try to make a margin. The margin similar to what we saw previously. Now what this margin will ensure is that this margin is some positive number we are having. Some positive number. So we are saying that the distance between anchor and positive should be at least greater than some margin than the distance between anchor and negative. So rather than it should be just, sorry, less than at least a margin. Okay. Now we are not saying that the distance of anchor and positive should be just less than distance of anchor and negative, but there should be a margin between them as well. Okay. So they should be less than by some margin. So by defining that margin, we have removed the triviality of the solution, because now the trivial solution is not possible. So if it tends to a trivial solution, there is a loss that will backpropagate. So the trivial solution is not possible.
One more thing is that with this margin, relaxation has also happened. And this is actually required. You will have to understand that if I only say that this thing has to be more than this, that we know that we wanted to have, then not only for this we started to have this alpha, but think it in this way, that's going to give you another flexibility in your function. The flexibility is that whenever I show you a positive pair, you no need to give me zero or something which is very low. Is it always possible that if I give you two same thing images, same subject images, and it's going to be huge amount of a very small value? It depends upon your intra-class variation. And problems are going to be in which intra-class variation is high. That is a big problem. You have to somehow handle the intra-class variation. If it is high, it's going to create problem. And your intra-class variation is high, and you are saying your network to give every time if I show you same image, then you'll have to give me zero. And right now you are looking this mobile phone from this direction, now you are looking in that direction. Same subject, same thing, but there are two different directions. It's huge amount of variation. In your data set, it's going to happen. Right now, it's looking to me in this direction, then slightly 30 degree angle. If you see me, something else you are seeing. He's seeing me in a completely different way. Profile face, you are seeing my front face. And if I say that match, it's not that every time you are going to get an exact match. Although subject remains to be the same. That is intra-class variation. So when I say that if it is different, if they are same, give me very small. It's every time not possible. On the contrary, if I give different things, so every time I have to say very big. No, it may be the case that things are very confusing. So inter-class variation should have to be high, but it may be low depending upon your problem. You are seeing a cat and a dog images and they are very similar to each other. So because of that, if now this type of relaxation alpha, it says that, remember, I am showing you two things, pair 1 and pair 2. One pair is positive pair, other pair is a negative pair. And I am not saying that you are supposed to, for this positive pair, you have to give me very low value. You probably may give me 0.2, 0.3. It's a high number. But with respect to this 0.2, you have to give me a very high value for the negative pair. Remember, I was giving this example to someone when I was explaining CMS. It's just like that you wanted to get very late in the morning. You say that, sir, I used to sleep very late, so I'm going to be wake up say at 11 or 12. So it's like ideally it is very bad. But then I will say that to compensate that you are going to be waking up that early. You have to be going to your bed very late. So as to compensate this thing. So is it, that's also okay for me that if you are, waking up at 11, that's also fine. If you are going to bed at 6 or 8 hours of that. So that is in the margin of 8 hours that you want to make. Margin of 8 hours of that sleep, that whenever you are sleeping and when you are going to wake up, there has to be a margin between them. No matter that when you are going to sleep or when you are going to wake up. This is actually an important thing. When you give your network this way, then only it will be able to handle properly your inter and intra class variations. Otherwise, what will happen? This network is not going to create any magic. If you show two images of the same person, and in a completely different environment, completely different angle and all, it's not going to say that he is the familiar person A or B. What will happen? Your network loss will not be decreased, your network will not be going to be converged. Because your data is having a huge amount of intra variation and less amount of inter-class variation. So I said this is the big problem. That's why anyway the problem of high intra-class variation and low inter-class variation. This will somehow adjust. This alpha is somehow going to give you that adjustment. And double-sided loss is going to help you.
So this is that the distance between anchor and positive plus alpha should be less than the distance between the anchor and negative. So we can just rewrite it as distance of anchor positive minus distance of anchor negative plus alpha is less than equal to 0. So you can see here, since this thing has to be less than equal to 0, we have to minimize this quantity, right? Because for the network to perform well, we need this to be as small as possible, right? So we have to minimize this quantity that we want. So if we minimize this quantity, what we want, the objective function is satisfied. So now, rather than having a pair, my network is actually having three inputs, A, P, and N. So at a time, I'm showing three images to my network, an anchor image, a positive image, and a negative image, rather than just showing a pair. I'm showing three images to a network, and the final loss can be seen as distance of AP minus distance of AN plus alpha. Right. So this is my loss function. The network has to minimize this loss function. Okay. But this one issue with this. Now suppose distance of AP is just 0.1, a very low distance, and distance of AN is very high, 1.0, but alpha is 0.5. Alpha is only 0.5. So this overall loss function tends to go to negative. Because the output of this will be minus 0.4. Right? The output of this, and we don't want that. So hence the same thing we do is we take a max 0, this whole term. So we take the max 0, the whole term that we were having, and this becomes my final loss function for triplet loss. Okay. So minimizing this loss function will, by showing three images to a network at a time rather than two images, will provide me the effect, that the complete effect. Now see here. Here, when I'm showing the three images, the task is clear. There's no toggling, as there was in contrastive loss. I'm not using any label at all. There's no label Y here. The toggling is not there. I'm not saying that one time do this, other time do that. No, I'm completely telling the network that, see, you have three images, you have three feature vectors. For two of those, you have to decrease the distance, and for two of those, you have to increase the distance. I'm telling the network in a single loss function, in a single back propagation, what is exactly that you need to do. So this way the problem of one-sided loss is solved in triplet loss, because then now the network is clear, okay, so these two images I have to bring close, and these two images I have to stretch them as far as possible. So now the network can actually learn the discriminative features because it's clear what it needs to be done. So this is triplet loss. This actually first came in the paper FaceNet by Google, and it was used for face recognition system. They created a face recognition system using it. But one problem with triplet loss is it's very elegant, yes, and it works wonderfully when we are having a very low number of data. Now suppose we just have four images of 100 classes, of 100 subjects. We just have four images per each subject, and we have 100 subjects. Can we train a classifier? No, we cannot, because four images are not enough to model a subject. The classifier won't be able to model a subject. But yes, now, if I choose triplets, if I choose pairs, how many such pairs would be possible? How many such triplets would be possible? A lot of them. High of them. So over these high pairs, it does not have to say that this belongs to this subject or this belongs to this subject. It has to just learn the discriminating features in the data set, that yes, these two images are of same subject and these two are images of different subject, irrespective of which subject they belong to. So since it's trying to learn just the how to differentiate between two subjects rather than trying to model a complete subject, it's actually able to do that. Even when the number of training data is very low. Very low training data it is with us. And this is the reason, because it forms triplets and it forms pairs, that's achievable. Okay. But still training triplet loss is not at all easy. It's not at all easy when we try to train a triplet loss. Now the major problem comes is, again, there's a bias, a huge bias between positive samples and negative samples. Because when I'm choosing a triplet, when I'm choosing A, P, and N, for a single AP, I have so many triplets possible. If I fix an anchor image and I fix a positive image, there are so many different triplets are possible. Right? So, because the number of classes or the number of different classes subjects, elements in the different classes is so large. So there's still a bias between positive samples and negative samples that I'm having. So what that bias makes is, what happens with this bias is that, now, what happens is, suppose I randomly choose a triplet for training, I have to choose a triplet, right? Suppose I randomly choose a triplet. Now since, see, randomly choosing a triplet, what would happen is that, since there are so many triplets possible there, if I randomly choose one, majority of them will actually be very easy to distinguish. See, like, suppose I have 10 classes, two of the classes are cheetah and leopard, but all of the other classes are completely different from each other, like car, aeroplane, and they're completely different. But two classes are completely similar. So now, if a triplet is being chosen from those two classes, then it's a good triplet for my training, because that's a problematic class. But if a triplet is chosen between cheetah and car, it's an easy triplet. The network can easily learn. But if a network learns to differentiate between cheetah and car, it won't be able to learn to differentiate between cheetah and leopard. But since there's only one such class which is probabilistic, rest all of the 100 classes are so easy, and if I randomly choose, what are the chances that I will actually pick the problematic class? Very low. Even if it's chosen, it will be chosen so unfrequently that a network can ignore that loss. That even if I give high loss for such a input, I'm okay with that. I won't backpropagate through that loss. I can ignore this. Right? So network won't be able to actually train. So when you're training the network, the loss will go very low. The training loss will go very low. But when you perform, when you actually see the performance of the network does not perform at all. So what we need to do here to solve this problem? Now, it showed that we cannot choose the negative samples randomly. We have a limited positive samples. We can choose all of the positive samples. But it showed that we cannot choose the negative samples randomly. So what can we do here?
The problem that he just has said that suppose that most of the triplets are going to be very easy. If triplets are very easy, then what is the problem?
So, sir, it will be able to differentiate between
harder triplets. So, the point is, as of first thing is that why they are being shown at some point of time, then they are not very frequent. That's the thing. You have got to understand that if your losses are going down, then what's the big problem? If your losses goes down, loss become very small, then what is the problem? Yes?
Network will
ignore. So if your loss is small, then derivative will be? And if that is the case, then learning will be stopped. So actually what happened that triplets, usually you have huge amount of, you know, triplets possible. All of them are there inside this room. You go and randomly select some and show it here because you cannot show all of your triplets. There are huge, exponentially many triplets. So out of that, you have to go inside this room. Every time you collect for a batch, your batch is say 1000, you take this 1000, show it to your network. And then train. And then you go next and then you train.
But when you see that very soon, your network loss becomes very small. And it got converged. And losses become so small that your network will not be in fact trained at all. Things become very small. Network got actually logged. If gradient, I mean, if your loss becomes very small, your network actually has got logged. And it has not logged because you have seen each and everything. You have not seen each and everything. You cannot see each and everything because you have huge amount of training samples, triplets which are in there. So there has to be a way. Instead of doing things randomly, how can I choose? Otherwise, if I'm not doing it properly, then what will happen? I will not be able to converge well. You will be converged to something which will not be able to differentiate. So you wanted to find, and most of the time these hard triplets are going to be very less. But if I say that what is hard triplet, it actually depends upon your network. Something which is hard for him may not be hard for you because you are being trained for that. So I have a network and I show some samples to it. Now this network is evolved. So this is suppose that same architecture network number one. Then I do what? Then I do and take another set of samples, show it to the same network. Now this N1 is converted into N2 network, got updated. And the hardness with respect to this network is continuously changing. The current network feels that something hard. Then what should I have to do? You have to train this network for this thing. Not during this period, it is evolved into another network. Now with respect to this, what is the hard? You will have to go and set, check that thing. And then show it. And then again, update it. And then get another set of, samples which are actually hard enough. So the point is that we will choose huge amount of things randomly from there, 1000 or something, and only train our network using those which are really hard. Hardest definition he is going to tell, but we have to have a notion that some triplets are hard, and this hardness is going to be not a global thing. You do not have a global estimate by which you are saying that this is hard or this is not hard. Global estimate you will only get once the network is completely trained.
and if it has been trained well, with respect to the given network, I do not want it to be long. Fine. So whatever the triplet that I have chosen, 1000, I will somehow find that who are those which are really hard with respect to this thing. This network is failing to differentiate between them. Then I take that and take the loss only of those and get my network back propagated somewhere. And then network is being changed, then I talk from other triplets which are hard. This is actually called as hard triplet mining. If you are not doing hard triplet mining, your network, Siamese is not definitely going to be trained. It will go to some place at some in that high dimensional space of parameter, it will go at some place and it goes very low. And as soon as you give your training data, it is not going to perform. It is going to perform very badly. Understood? So hardness is going to talk about.
So that's why what we perform is we perform online hard negative mining. So why hard negative mining? Because we have so many hard samples and we only want so many negative samples and we only want to choose the hard ones. So those will actually give a loss to my network and ignore the others. And why online? Because as the sir said, that the network at a point, the hardness, the samples that will be hard for a network at a point might not be hard later on. Other samples that were not hard at this point might be hard at a later point. So the hardness is actually dependent upon the network that we are having at that moment. So hence this mining has to be done in an online fashion at the current network that I am having, rather than just doing once before. I cannot do that. I need to hard them in an online fashion. So what we do is, for online hard negative mining, what we do is we just choose randomly some 1000 triplets. Suppose a network is trained. I have one trained network N. Okay. I choose some randomly 1000 triplets. Right? I have chosen some 1000 triplets. I make a forward pass through this N for all the 1000 triplets. Okay. I make a forward pass through this N for all the 1000 triplets. Now for each triplet, what I will get? I will get... So each triplet, I will get XA, XP, and XN. Right, for each triplet, I have got the feature embeddings XA, XP, and XN. Right, I can compute the distances. So I can compute distance of AP, and I can compute distance of AN. Right, now what would happen is, if I just chose a triplet randomly, most probably that the distance of AP will actually be less than distance of AN, but it will be less than distance of AN if my network is trained. Okay, distance of AP will be less than distance of AN. So let me just put A here, P here, and let's say my N is here. So distance AP, and this is the distance AN. So P is actually closer to A than N, right? The distance is closer to that. But the point is, the difference between them can be greater than alpha. Right. The distance between them, the difference between these two distances can be greater than alpha. Right? If we choose randomly, then this distance will be greater than alpha. So if this distance is greater than alpha, and if we go to the loss function, so this distance is 0.1, this distance comes out to be 1.0 and alpha is 0.5. Let's assume this is the case. The distance between AP comes out to be 0.1. AN is 1.0 and alpha is 0.5. What will be the overall loss? Zero. We are doing also the max as well. The overall loss is zero. So if we choose this triplet and train via this triplet, is there any training happening? No. So we will ignore such triplets. So we will ignore those triplets whose distance of anchor negative minus distance of anchor positive is greater than or equal to alpha. We will ignore those triplets. So we will ignore such ones where the difference is already greater than or equal to alpha, because these will provide me a loss of zero, but I will only choose those triplets whose AN minus distance AP is less than alpha.
Okay.
So if I'm just choosing these triplets from all the 1000 triplets that I have randomly, I randomly took. So if the network is properly trained, I will get very few. I might get 100, 200 such triplets only. But I will only train by those 100 and 200 triplets. And once I have trained by those 100 and 200 triplets, that was actually harder. Okay. Then I will again choose some 1000 random triplets. Then I will again do the forward pass. Again compute those triplets which are hard. And then only train by hard triplets. So I will keep on doing that once, keep on repeating that while training, so that I can actually perform the online hard negative mining while my network is being trained. Right. But there's another concept. This is completely hard negative mining. When we're using hard negative mining, it sometimes creates problem in the starting. Because see, at the starting, when the network is not at all trained, the case can also be that A, positive, negative. That positive is far off and negative is really close. Such a case can also come at starting, when we're just starting the network. The network is not at all trained. So such cases will give a very high loss. Very, very, very high loss. Such cases will provide very high loss. And these high losses can actually make my network unstable. This will provide very high loss, giving me a very high gradient, and they can make the network highly unstable. So I need to ignore such elements as well. So I have to choose the hard elements, but I don't have to choose very, very hard elements also. The elements which are such elements that A and N are very close as compared to A and P. One can also say that these elements are the outliers. I don't want the network to be trained via the outliers. There can be some outliers in the data, right? There can be a photo of a car that looks like an aeroplane, maybe some scenario. I don't know. They can be outliers in the data. Okay, so I don't want the network to learn from these outliers to learn just something else. Okay, so what I do is I also keep another constraint with this, that D of AN should be greater than or equal to D of AP. So with these two constraints, so both the constraints that yes, the distance between them should be less than alpha, but the distance of AN should be greater than distance of AP. So having these both the constraints, we do hard negative mining so that neither the easy triplets are chosen nor very hard triplets are chosen, just the hard ones that are very good for my training, because the easy ones are also not good for training and very hard ones are also not good for training, just the middle ones, those I actually want to see, the ones that are actually helpful for me. So using these two constraints, we choose those triplets in an online fashion after every, let's say, 1000 random triplets we chose, and we keep on repeating this process till the network trains.
Any questions till now, if you want to ask, if I can have some questions. You can ask anything if you are confused. If you want to ask, is it okay? Are you sure? No? Anything till now of Siamese network, if you want, then you can get yourself clear. No problem. Then you talk about documentation.
Yeah. See, another way to handle the bias is, see, sometimes what we do is, we have chosen a triplet, A, P, N. We have chosen a triplet, and yes, this triplet is a hard triplet. We have done the mining. What we can do is to increase the, for more better training, we can augment only the positive samples. We do data augmentation only on the positive samples. So this way actually the positive samples are increased, but the negative samples are the same. They are not increased at all. So this data augmentation over the positive samples helps me in, also helps me for fighting the bias problem that I am having, that positive samples are really low while the negative samples. But I never do that for negative samples, because I already have so many negative samples. I don't do that for negative samples at all. Okay. I only do data augmentation for positive samples. It's implementation issue. You can actually do before, like you can keep the augmentations before as well, but make sure that they are never chosen in negative pairs. You can do augmentation later on as well. Sometimes this, because augmentation is sometimes slow, so what we do is we keep the augmented data before, and then for those chosen ones, we choose the augmented ones, and for negative ones, we never chose from the augmented ones. So that the online, when we are doing the augmentation, then the system becomes very slow. So it's on the implementation. But yes, it's only chosen for those samples which are only chosen as hard. The one which we'll be training on, it will be only chosen for those samples. Yeah, I will keep an augmentation for every class. I'll make the augmentations for every class. Okay, but I will only choose these augmented images when they are being chosen as a positive pair. Now suppose I have 4 images of each class, right? Of 100 classes. From these 4, I suppose I have made 35. So out of these 35, I had 4 and 31 were my augmented images. Right. So when I am choosing a negative sample, I will only choose a negative sample from these 4 images only, my original images. But for choosing the positive samples, I will use all of the 35 images. Because already I have so many negative samples, I don't want to increase my negative samples. So the negative samples I am choosing by the original 4 that I was having, but for positive samples I am choosing from the 35 images, the augmented images.
So now how to do this augmentation? You can say that how one can do augmentation, there are multiple ways by which you can do, like rotation, then you can do some sort of translation of the image, you can scale it, you can blur it, you can do some sort of coloring variation, so many ways by which you can do this augmentation. But suppose that you are working over a data set and you are training. So while training, you have huge amount of triplets that are being created using the training data. Testing data is here, you cannot touch that while training. So over your training data, you have come up with huge amount of triplets and you are training over that. And after that, your log and hard triplet mining, everything you have done. And later, what has happened? That when you take this network and test it, you have seen that the error is not very low. The problem is, suppose that your data set is actually illumination variation data set. Illumination variation data set is like that I am continuously clicking your face 5 times. But once the light is at this angle, once the light at that angle, once the light at that angle, so what is happening is that different face parts are going to be illuminated one by one. Now first 3 images are in your training and last 2 are in the testing. You have not seen that type of illumination in your training sample. Fine, and you have come up with huge amount of triplets. When you train, when you test, you are not going to get very less performance, I mean, the loss is not going to be very low. So when you wanted to augment in such cases, you will have to understand that what type of data that you are expecting in your test samples. Test sample may be viewing angle variation. Right now here, and this way, so I am viewing in a different angle. So if it is a viewing angle variation, if it is a lighting variation, if it is scale variation, I'm taking the same face image, but right now at this distance, then this distance, and another distance. So scale variation is there. Rotation, I take this, and that way. I'm taking the image as an angle variation. So you have to understand that what type of samples you are going to get in your test. And with respect to that, if you augment your data here, then what will happen? That type of augmentation is definitely going to help you to achieve better performance over your test samples. In general, there are at least 10 to 15 different ways by which you can do this augmentation. Please read about that, what are the different ways by which you can do augmentation. If I give you an image and I say that, can you rotate? There is simple sin theta cos theta formula, two dimensional matrix, you multiply it by image and got rotated, it got scaled, color got changed and so on. So augmentation is going to help so as to fight with your bias problem. Triplet losses are going to help so as to come up with the better, you know, two-sided loss function. And hard triplet mining is going to help so as to combat from the problem of simple or easy triplets, because there are huge exponentially many triplets and most of them are going to be fairly trivial or easy to differentiate, and your network will learn from them. So it got stuck to some local minima, you will not be able to perform well on your tests.
Just one last thing in Siamese networks. So here, this alpha is a very important hyperparameter that we are having. Okay, We have talking about we will keep a margin, but how much margin to keep? If we keep a very small margin, it's very simple for a network to learn what the task is. But small margin won't have that much discriminability. For testing data, the network won't perform that well. The generalizability of the network will be low. So hence, when keeping small margin, it's easier for network to learn, but the network is not that much generalized. But if we keep a very high margin, then the learning for the network becomes very tough. But if the network is able to learn that high margin, the network is more generalized because the discrimination is more effective in that case. So hence, to combat this, what we found out was, we first keep a very low alpha. We let the network train. Okay, we are training the network with a low alpha, let's say 0.2. And at every time when we are doing the online hard negative mining, we are getting some hard negative samples. Once those hard negative samples fall below some threshold, let's say 50, from 1000 random samples, I'm choosing some hard samples. Now let's say those hard samples falls below a threshold of 50, what I will do is I will increment my margin. Because now I'm sure for this margin of 0.2, my network has learned. I'm only getting very few hard samples, so my network has learned how to discriminate for this margin. So I will increment my margin. And then again I will start training the network from that point. And I will keep on incrementing this margin till the margin becomes a bit higher margin, like 1, 0.8 or 1. So that way, by using this dynamically adaptive margin, what happens is the network is actually able to learn very wonderfully, because first its task is a simple task, just to differentiate by 0.2. When it's learned, then I'm just increasing the complexity of task by small, make it 0.25, make it 0.3. So network is able to actually learn its way very well to a very high margin, say of 1. And since at the end the margin is very high, the network is generalized as well. So this is another technique that we found out is very useful while training the triplet losses and Siamese networks. That's it for that. Sir, quiz.
Quiz, we are going to have our quiz on the mini quiz.